point, I'll start improvising with the 5/2, you know, ratio. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Please hold your applause. And then, you know, do a Brazilian, you know, baião. And I'll be accenting a lot of the E's and U's. The reason why I point that out is so you know that there's a rhythmic thought process going on there, that it doesn't sound like I've just pushed a drum set down a stairwell, you know, with a bunch of random, you know, oh, you're just playing crap on top of that. So I'm actually thinking of certain rhythmic shapes when I'm doing that. And I try to keep things in a musical context, because even though I'm just playing solo drums, this is a musical instrument, or a bunch of musical instruments together. And I'm trying to play music still. I'm not trying to twirl my sticks on fire and, you know, and do that whole bit. I'm trying to play music here. You know, and sometimes it's there, and better days than others. But I'm going to do my best for you today. I've been on the road for a little bit here. We've done 7 shows in 9 days. So I'm a little loopy, a little tired. So I just want to have fun with you guys today and play and get in a nice dialogue and answer any of your questions about anything, you know, musical related or not. We'll just chat. So, sound good?
Yeah.
All right. Cool. All right. So I'm gonna get underway here. And Doug, I'm gonna fire up the first track. Here's the Jerry Goodman song. So, enjoy. Thank you. Yeah, I like that one. I want to stick with that one. Thank you. All right. Continuing.
We'll be right back.
Thanks, guys. That being said, I mean, this is fun to come out here and do this, but the most important thing, if you want to work as a musician, you want other musicians to want to play with you and want to hire you, you got to be able to play songs and grooves really well, you know, really, really strong. Just be able to play music and all that stuff is fun, but again, we're musicians and we're playing music and we want to work and pay our bills and get hired by playing music, right? All right, well, cool. Everyone's leaving. Anyone ever want to talk about anything? George, work on my groove. Play to music. I mean, just try. Really, an important thing you can do is record yourself, because what you play at the time you're playing it, you might think it's happening, and then you listen to it. I mean, how many have had that experience? You're playing with your band or whatever, and you think it's really happening, and then you listen to it back, you're like, there's no way we were playing it that fast, or, you know, or it just wasn't feeling good at all. So, you know, playing with some sort of metronomic device that you can hear clearly without blasting your heads, your ears out, and recording yourself and listening to it back, and that's a tough thing, and that also adds that much more time on your practice time, because you got to sit there and sort of relive it, and listen to it objectively, and then try to figure out if something's not feeling the way you want it to feel, or if it doesn't feel good, figure out if you need to put a little bit more space. You know, if for some reason your the backbeat of four of every fourth bar seems to be on top, you have to make those little adjustments. And it's the same thing you do in the studio. You know, there's times where I go do a take, and even though I feel I'm burying it with a click, I go in there and I listen to it. I'm like, I want to kill myself. I'm embarrassed to be standing right here in front of everybody. You know, so I want to go out there and do another take as quickly as possible. But that happens. So just listen to yourself and make the adjustments. Be honest with yourself. Deal with it and pat yourself on the back when something comes out the way you wanted it to come out. And hopefully, you'll start to tighten up those points where things will mostly feel the way you want it to feel. What do I use to practice fills? Well, technique is not like it's not a means to an end. You know, I mean, technique is. I look at learning things on the drums like when you learn how to spell words and then you learn how to put sentences together. It's very much the same way. And then it's up to you how to use those sentences. You know, you could write like, you know, Shakespeare or Faulkner, or you could write like a email, you know, or a blog on, you know, MySpace or something, you know. It's up to you how you're going to write with it. So, I mean, I might look at something like, I just look at like alternating flam triplets, you know, like. What can I do with those? You can flatten the flams. You can put doubles on the accent. You can flatten them, orchestrate them around the toms. Now what else can we do? We can do the doubles. We can do other phrases with it. like the Swiss Army and not alternate. Open it up, tighten it up. The flam drag, Tony Williams bit. And I see a lot of guys are playing the Tony Williams thing. That was, you know, back in the early 80s, there was really only a couple of guys I ever heard doing that. It was Vinnie Colaiuta, Steve Smith, and Tony Williams. And I'm sure there's other guys on the planet that played it. But I remember being like 13 years old and stumbling upon the... And I'm like, that's it. That's what those guys are doing. So that was my secret weapon for a little while, but a lot of guys are using that now a lot, and the kind of like the secret's out on that lick. So there's a lot of other ways. How many of you guys have the Tony Williams lick in your arsenal? Raise your hand. Some people call it the blige, though. When I grew up, I called it the gablige, because it's, you know, I was like, one, two, gablige, gablige, go, go, one. Anyway, you know, there's a lot of guys that are doing that, and a lot of guys are using it in a very one-dimensional way with just... And it's a cool lick, but also there's got to be a little, like... There's got to be a little attitude behind that one, because you're pretty much... It's like you're projectile vomiting, you know? Just, you know? There's got to be some attitude behind that. But I, you know, there's a lot of guys that I never see them orchestrating that in different ways. Like, why not just keep the hand here? That sounds cool too, doesn't it? You're just doing doubles on the toms. Never see, or on the hi-hat. You got to think about other ways to take a lick or a rudiment and sort of put your own spin on it. And, you know, it's you playing it, so it's going to sound like you, but come up with some interesting variations that instead of, you know, now everyone's... Hey, I know that one too. Do something else cool with it, you know? And like what I was doing before by stringing all those things together, hopefully that made sense about, here's an idea, and expound from that. Again, just like learning how to spell a word, then using a word in a sentence, being able to diagram sentences. And all those are just very sort of exercise-y type of things that, you know, you're still hearing. You can still practice in a musical way where you're still hearing dum 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 melodies on the toms. But then it's up to you, you know, how are you going to use that playing music with other musicians or using that in, you know, okay, you got an 8-bar solo and then trying to say something with it. Again, it's all words. It's all words. You're saying something with these instead of words, but it's the exact same thing, I think, anyway. What I want to impart to you and help inspire is to play music and to listen to music. I mean, I was kind of talking to Tim. I hope I'm not, you know, speaking out of school, so to speak. But, you know, Tim said that sometimes, you know, he asked the student, like, what do you listen to? And no one really has an answer what they're listening to. It's like, you guys are studying to be musicians. You can't just practice all the time. What are you practicing for? You know, there has to be a context of practicing, playing music. And if you want to work, you have to play songs. And you have to want to play songs. And, you know, like I said, you could play triple stroke rolls at 210 with your feet and twirling your sticks, and you'll never get a gig unless someone is looking exactly for that. you know, but work on your own playing. You know, I know everyone wants, you know, to be in bands, and everyone would like, you know, like to get, you know, famous and, you know, be in a big rock band. And, you know, I did that in my 20s, and I was in bands, and but I always knew, like, I have to work on myself. And the more I know, the more gigs I can do, the more people that I meet and play with, good things will happen. And the Styx gig came up with, because I was doing a lot of sessions in Chicago in the early to mid 90s, where there's a lot of jingle work, and I was doing 20, 30 sessions a month. I didn't want to move to LA, like, why would I, you know, and leave all this? And it was because I, you know, was playing weddings, and I knew how to play waltzes and foxtrots and polkas and horas and all that stuff. I knew how to do those, and I would get called back for gigs, and I showed up at hotels with a tuxedo, and I did my work. That led to doing a lot of sessions. That led to the guy who handled my cartage for the drums had worked with the band Styx, and when John Panazzo, the original drummer, was ill, he recommended me to go in and do some recording for them. So there wasn't a cattle call. I didn't win the lottery, you know, and that's kind of what it is. If you put all your eggs in one basket with a band, I mean, that's great to, you know, be brothers and be into it. But just always isn't in the back of your head. It's easier to look after yourself than it is, you know, three or four or five other human beings. You know, does that make sense? Okay.
I've been.
Thank you, guys.